the floor gets dusty, when your play gets busted, with a shins, when your broom smells funny, when a hex takes your money, what's gonna save you, honey? Just with a shins, with a shins. All you witches and all your old magicians, it's time to start listening to with a shins, with a shins. When your play gets busted, with a shins, when your broom smells funny, when a hex takes your money, what's gonna save you, honey? Just with a shins, all you witches and all your old magicians.
Hips, intravenous cigarettes, in fear of turning blind. Head of gray, as some guys say, shows you growing old. Do it again, I can't explain. The light sure seems so cold. Some blues, time to choose. Oh, why your heart is just a stabbing. Bloody eyes can't describe the nature of your hacking. Back to front, the blade tastes blunt. In the safety of your bedroom, desire to touch the fire is just a sad obsession.
Feel the pain, it leaves no stain, it leaves no stain. Feel the pain,
the name of the game.
The name I've got.
beautiful day. It's such a beautiful day in the neighborhood. The sun is shining, flowers are blossoming, snotty little kids waking up their parents. It's such a beautiful day. It's such a beautiful day. It's such a beautiful day in the neighborhood. The birds are chirping, lawnmowers hunting, barbecue burning, dead animals. It's such a beautiful day. Day. It's such a fishing day. It's such a wonderful day. It's such a beautiful day. It's such a gorgeous day. It's such a happy day. It's such a beautiful day in the
Division on Wittershins Radio. Radio for your spiritual side. A twisted approach to the left-hand path and all the paths in between. You are here on a very special day. This is the kickoff to our marathon of broadcasts, trying to interview every WitchCon presenter we can. We can't interview them all. There's over 100 because it's the largest online magical festival that there ever was. And the lineup is epic. Huge names, people, including myself, of course. But seriously, we are going to be here almost every day on Wittersons Radio. We might not be here every day on TikTok. That's just a little special treat for you TikTok people to see the video behind the radio kind of thing. But we're going to be here almost every day. Tomorrow, if you're listening to the live broadcast, or, well, still, it'll be the next broadcast in the fucking lineup in the archives. We're doing it twice, man. We're doing it twice. We got two episodes. We got, I don't even know how to say her name, so I'm not even going to say it yet. But, Fatima, and I don't know how to say her last name. Exactly. So I'm going to ask her how to pronounce her name at the beginning of the show because that's what polite people do. And that's what I do. And then we got a 3-hour break, and then we're coming back. Then we're going to interview Fiona Horn at 10 o'clock Central Time in the U.S. So two broadcasts for the price of one. Two for the price of one. We're working overtime, man. So we're going to be here like pretty much almost every day this month. We still either still have a couple slots open that we could get presenters in.
Are you going to hog the camera now?
Well, now that Marta's here, I'm going to turn the camera because, okay. You know, Marta wanted to get, you know, do her girly stuff.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did. Now I'm trying to get an angle. Okay. I got to kind of lean my phone weird. So we're like at an angle. It's like the villain's house in Batman. We're at a 45-degree angle here. Okay, that's cool. I can be the villain. But tonight, the dogs are going to bark at shit. Listen to it. That's why nobody fucks with our house right there.
The cats cross the street when they walk by our house.
The demons are at the door.
Remember, it went like in the middle of the street, and then when it passed our house, it went back on the sidewalk.
But tonight, to kick off the marathon, I can't think of a better place to start. We got Father Sebastian.
Yeah.
Man we personally met, that we never actually ended up hanging out with when we were in Hollywood. Always kind of meant to. Always kind of was going to have him on Wittersons back in the day, but just never got around to it. And here we are in New Orleans, and he's on the list of presenters at WitchCon. And so we have so many people that we're going to get to know better, you know, having him on Wittersons.
Yeah.
And we're having Ellie Barnes actually coming to the house. Be our fourth actual in-person studio guest. I think the first was Patty Negri.
Mm-hmm. Negri.
I fucked a name up back then too. But pretty rare to have us, you know, in the house of Wittersons.
Especially during COVID.
Yeah. Now we got Father Sebastian on here. Now he didn't tell me to call him this, but I'm gonna call him this because it's my show and I can. He's the vampire king, dudes. He's the king of the fucking vampires, man. I can't think of any more known fucking vampire than Father Sebastian.
Yeah, nor I.
And, long time resident on with Ghost Adventures on the Travel Channel. Patty's also there a lot, too. I think he's still doing that. We'll find out about that. He's authored several books. I'm going to have him tell you about the books. The two largest vampire gatherings in the fucking world. He runs those two. A lot of stuff. See, now we learn about our guests before we have them on. And he makes fangs for people. And he used to be a dental assistant. That's where he learned.
I think his group, is it called the Sabretooth?
I don't know. We're going to ask him.
Yeah.
Father Sebastian, merry meet again, sir. How the fuck are you? Hello. Welcome to Wittersons.
Oh, thank you for having me. It's COVID's almost over, hopefully.
Oh, God, I hope so. Then I don't know what we're going to do with our Stay the Fucking Home show.
We're going to do the Get the Fuck Out show.
We're going to do the Get the Fuck Out show.
Yeah. I already came up with what we're
going to
do.
We're going to the Vampire Cafe.
Yep.
We've been wanting to go there for a while now.
Yeah, I already asked her if our two large dogs are okay, and she said that's fine.
Their teeth should fit right in.
Yeah.
Marita's a dog person.
She told me. Yeah.
I think she showed us pictures of her
dog. Yeah, I think she might have sent me a picture of her dog, I think. I don't know.
Yeah. Now, first, before we go into all that, Father Sebastian, have you been to Potions? In New Orleans?
Yes, of course.
That's what I thought.
The first time we came here, which was for Hexfest in 2019, we pretty much lived at Potions when we weren't at Hexfest.
We didn't go to anybody's workshops.
I mean, during the day, it's closed.
We didn't have our kid. We didn't have the dog. It was the freest we've been in a little while. So, those of you who don't know, you probably can't find it. It's a speakeasy in New Orleans. You got to go through the back of this bar and know the secret code word. And the speakeasy is run by the vampires here.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if it was Hexfest weekend, specific or not, but from my gauging, it was entirely populated by witches.
Mm-hmm.
Witches and witch vampires.
Mm-hmm.
So it was the coolest fucking time I ever had, and probably
I remember
we moved to New Orleans.
We were walking back to the hotel, it was 1:30 or something, and you said, "This is the most fun I've had in years and years and years."
I'm sure I was slurring when I said that at that point. So, Father.
Is that when you broke your bandera?
That is. I picked up my beads off the street and put them in my pocket before I lost anything. Yeah. You broke my bandera.
Oh, I didn't.
Yes, you did. You're holding your drunk ass up. Anyways, we got Father Sebastian here. We got to talk to him.
Yeah.
You're just yapping all the time, woman.
I don't know why he's listening to you too.
So you're in California still, right?
Yeah, I travel around quite a bit. I've been based in LA for quite a while, and I love LA. I think LA is my home soul, my home spirit. But time to move. I need to be a gypsy again.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm setting up a base in Vegas in the next couple months with a new project called Babylon, the Vampire Court of Babylon.
Hmm. Vampire Court of Babylon.
It's going to be with the House of Blues, like in New Orleans. And this is my secret project that I'm first announcing on your show.
Ooh, announce it again then.
Well, Babylon.
Babylon.
It's inspired by a couple sources, but mainly Jack Parsons and L. Ron Hubbard doing a ritual in 1946 in L.A. And they were trying to invite the Whore of Babylon into the world.
That sounds
Crowley
fun.
Follower. Yeah. Gotta love them.
Absolutely.
And Babylon is a VIP, very important vampire project. Mm-hmm. That's going to be a Regency artist salon. So it's going to have Regency style stuff. And it's going to be at the Foundation Room at the House of Blues in Vegas.
Wow. That's awesome.
At the top of the Mandalay Bay.
Mm-hmm.
And you can find out for me, you can sign up for the membership list, application list. Because you got to apply to be a member. And we're going to build a magical world at the top of the Mandalay Bay once a month.
Wow. That's awesome.
That does sound fun.
Mm-hmm.
You do a huge vampire gathering at the House of Blues here, too, right? What's that called?
I do. That's called the New Orleans Vampire Ball, produced by Endless Night Productions.
Okay.
Cool. And when is that?
That's Halloween weekend every year. It's a whole 4-day event.
Okay.
This year we've got a lot of surprises coming up because we kind of had to skip the last year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what was amazing? We still ran the event from the House of Blues with 12 people in the venue instead of 1,500. And I broadcast. And it was awesome. We did a great job. And the team came together. We all flew to New Orleans in the middle of a pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
We rented a house. I got them in a COVID secure bubble, made everybody get tested, checked everybody's temperature, and we had 12 crew members at the House of Blues on the thing, like a living room. It was pretty crazy.
That That is pretty crazy.
Yeah.
Well, cool. Well, hopefully this year we'll be able to have it. I mean, we've got to have it checked by then.
Yeah.
I mean, we just moved to New Orleans, so we don't even know what a Halloween in New Orleans would have been like.
Yeah. We have no idea.
I'm going to tell you, I came in 1995 and I never stopped.
Yeah. They got to do Halloween well. You know? Mm-hmm. It's perfect.
Yeah, I would think. A lot of our friends go to Salem for Halloween, but Salem won't be here. Yeah.
Well, so Salem and Halloween and Queens and Halloween are two totally different things.
Yeah.
But they're just, they're most amazing. I mean, New Orleans is, you know, my first Halloween in New Orleans, if you want me to tell you about it, changed my life. And Salem is also an amazing city, mm-hmm. absolutely amazing. But they're two different experiences, and it really depends on what you're looking for.
Right. Well, we'll probably end up doing both sooner or later. Yeah. But
once COVID's gone, we find babysitters, that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Well, let me tell you, as an event producer, COVID will never be gone.
Okay? Yeah.
But it will become like the flu.
Yeah. We'll have like 10 different vaccines for all the 10 different variants, and everybody will be on everything.
The more it changes, the weaker it gets. So, yeah, I mean, the flu was probably a lot worse when it first, you know.
Because my day job is as a dental technician, and I work in a dental lab. So I've been back.
Okay, I read that about you.
Yeah, I make the teeth that you need for chewing and stuff.
The teeth I don't have. Yeah, I need some of those.
What?
Yeah.
The teeth for chewing and stuff. I don't have those teeth.
So are you, for now, are you technically in Hollywood in L.A.?
Yeah. I'm here until the 1st of March. Uh-huh. And then I'm going up to San Francisco for a little bit. And then I'm going to make my way to Vegas eventually. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm waiting for a house to be finished being built in Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
And we're May 2nd for Walpurgis, better known to American Celtic pagans as Beltane.
Mm-hmm.
We are hosting the first Babylon event. Only on COVID response, of course. I'm very, very, very devoted to a good COVID reaction response. And we'll only do it if it's safe. And we have worked with the House of Blues Foundation Room, which is the most beautiful room in Las Vegas, to accommodate the schedule so we can postpone it. And it's going to be a magically run event. It's going to be an event for magical people. Mm-hmm. And Vegas is becoming a magical center point.
Yeah, I was just going to ask you, what's that scene like in Vegas, like as far as witches and vampires and all that?
Well, it's more of a destination place. You mm-hmm. know, Betty can drive there from L.A. for 3 or 4 hours.
Yeah.
Okay. The main benefits of it are for business. If you're a business owner, you set up in Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
You don't in California.
No.
Holy crap. Las Vegas, you know, you got Zach Bagans' Haunted Museum from Ghost Adventures, which is like, you can't get a better collection of haunted artifacts in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And he's a pretty big character there. And then there's the Count. I mean, from vampire perspective, there's Zach Bagans, who does a little bit of vampire stuff. We did the Vegas Vampire Ball at the Artisan Hotel, which was amazing for 2 years in a row, but that didn't work after the COVID kind of killed that.
Yeah.
And then there's the Count's Customs. He's kind of like, he owns Vamped, which is like a Hard Rock Cafe for vampires.
Okay.
So, but the magical community is really cool. You're right near Area 51, so you got all the alien guys.
Uh-huh.
The Burning Man community is really big there.
Yeah.
You know, they're in a desert already.
Right.
And then there's the pegging community, which I haven't really gotten to know yet, and I'm curious about them.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that there's about 7 or 8 esoteric esoteric shops, new age shops, which is pretty cool. Mm-hmm. A little different from LA, which we have more, you know, we've got some amazing shops in Los Angeles.
Well, yeah, well, they like, got Sedona over there. There's probably all kind of shops
near Sedona's Sedona. In Arizona.
What are you talking about, Arizona? Yeah. Oh, Las Vegas.
Sedona. LA is known for a couple things, okay? Patty Negri's backyard is the center of the magical ley lines on Earth right now. There is no more powerful place to do rituals than her grove. She has a grove in her backyard.
Wow. I've seen her backyard. I've seen
we never
front yard.
Made it over to her house.
Well, no, we were in front of her house.
No, I know, but we haven't been in our yard or anything.
We were always supposed to go right to a seance or something, but we never pulled it off.
Well, we're going to have her do it.
Right now, the magical universe, the existence of magic itself is in Patty's backyard.
Wow.
There is no more magical place that I have ever been in my life than her grove in her backyard.
Wow. I wish we'd known this sooner. I just would have invited myself over.
A grove in Hollywood, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, it was probably could have thrown a rock at it from our place. We were up high.
Yeah.
We were up kind of over the thing.
Yeah.
All that stuff.
Well, you know, there was a nightclub in L.A. called Cloak and Dagger, which was a witch nightclub. It was a club for witches.
Uh-huh.
Did you guys get to attend that?
No, Cloak and Dagger.
We got a kid, you know. So,
no.
We were going to go to the Viper Room, and there was what's that other thing we were going to go to for the longest time?
What other thing?
It started at midnight. I don't even remember what it was called.
I forgot. It's on Cherokee.
Yeah.
I'll remember.
It wasn't specifically the bar. It was an event that happened at the bar at a particular time.
Bar Sinister.
Yes, that's
Bar Sinister.
Thank you.
Yeah, we never pulled that out either because we got kids.
Cloak and Dagger, every Tuesday night, was a members-only club. You had to wear all black. Adam Braben from She Wants Revenge was the DJ. And they had rituals every night of varying different traditions. You go there, you do the Saturno ritual, then you do a French voodoo ritual next week, then you do a Norse Restu ritual, and then and like every week was a different ritual, and it was posh. You'd have Moby and Dita Von Teese hanging out there. Wow. It was awesome. The COVID killed it, like many things.
Right. Was it in Hollywood?
It was in Hollywood at the Pig and Whistle. It was at 1666 McAdden.
Okay. I know where that is.
And you had to wear all black. If you showed up with, like, a white streak on your shoe, you had to take your shoes off.
It would have fit right in.
Yeah. It, literally, the cream of the crop of the magical community, nightlife and creative community was there. Musicians, Dave Navarro was there. It was just nuts. It was the coolest club. I mean, I run events. So I run events and nightclubs. I don't run nightclubs.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't manage a venue or anything like that. But the magic and mystery of Cloak and Dagger was something that was an aeonic event. It was an eon. It was an aeon. It was the magic in there. Sadly, it had a tragic end with COVID and some other issues occurred. But, you know, I've seen events come and go. And there was only one other place that was as magical as Cloak and Dagger, and that was a club called Mother in the 90s at 435 Washington Street,
90s,
New York.
We're probably in Santa Cruz.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Santa Cruz?
Cool. That was in between our times. She grew up in Hollywood.
I actually grew up in West Hollywood, but then I moved to Santa Cruz in the 90s, and that's where we spent most of it. That's where we met.
There's some vampire stuff going on there, too.
Yeah.
And vampires get around.
Yeah. I don't know. I haven't seen them lately. I mean, when we still live.
Yeah, vampire culture moves around.
Yeah.
Secret of the vampires. You know how to tell a real vampire versus a non-real vampire?
Uh-uh.
No, tell us.
They spell vampire with a Y. That's the secret.
I saw that on some of the stuff when I was looking up some of the stuff you did, but sometimes it was I and sometimes it was Y.
I was looking at the menu in the cafe that opened, and she spells it with the Y.
Mm, so So those are real vampires.
Well, see, you'll see it subtly spelled with a Y here and there, and that's the secret code for vampires to know each other.
That's kind of like we used to do with ICK for magic.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's kind of...
You still do that?
not as many people using that now, but yeah, that used to be...
are you sure?
Between the two.
Yeah, I see a lot of people still using the K.
Yeah, but it used to be like the standard for like if you were in like the actual magic to differentiate from Hocus Pocus. I think it was like a lot of the ATR influence and stuff. They always wanted to spell it with a C. And those were the first people I saw on the scene spelling it with a C after we've been doing the ICK forever. And, now Mardo's just editing a book where she had to search all of those out. Sometimes it was spelled with a C, sometimes it was spelled with a K.
Yeah, like she starts out spelling it with a C, and I thought, okay, well, it's an ATR, so I'm not going to mess with it. But then like halfway down, she started using a K, so I have to go back and put all the Ks in.
Times change.
Yeah, my publisher, I used to run Vampire Magazine and published the Vampire Almanac, inspired by the Witch's Almanac.
Mm-hmm.
And tell you, my publisher, I had fights with him. Oh, my God. I'm like, I'm spelling it with a Y. It's like, no, you're not. And I'm like, oh, hell yeah, I am. And I finally bought the rights back from my book. And I said, hell, I'm spelling it with the next edition with a Y. Yep. And he wanted me to do it for social media. And Vampire Ball is an I, because that's the legend, the myth, the front.
Mm-hmm.
The Vampire with a Y is the way I go, man.
Vampire with a Y. All right. Well, we learned something today already.
Yeah.
Yes. So
it's like anybody who knows real magic or practices real witchcraft and respects magic in its most fundamental, honorable form, spells it with a CK. Because you go to the magic castle, you spell it with an IC.
Right.
An ICK is magic. It differentiates the two. And only... You know, people, why take away magic from magicians? Magic Castle's an amazing place.
Yeah.
Well, you know, when I was a kid, I did magic with the C. I was pretty good at it. And some of those ideas I later used in magic with an ICK. One of the things I remember bringing over was flash paper. You ever played with flash paper? So, like, you take like your standard petition ritual, or you've got a sigil on a piece of paper, you're going to burn it, but a piece of flash paper. It's like you throw it into the air, it makes a puff of flame and disappears. No ash, nothing. That's magic with the CK. But I took it from the magic with the C people.
Yeah.
I appropriated.
You appropriated. Oh, man.
Yeah, like, I talked to Christian Day. Do you know this guy? You know Christian Day?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, really? I heard he's a pretty controversial cat.
He is.
But so are we.
He's actually a really good friend of ours. He helped us pick our house out.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah.
We did a lot of it from Hollywood. And, you know, he had to school us of the different neighborhoods and the floodplain map. That was really important.
Yep.
And he actually, this was his hands down house that he picked. It's like, well, okay, we don't, you know, we spent a weekend here, so, or I guess we then came back and spent another weekend when we were looking for a house, or a week, but that's all we knew. So, you know,
I think it was the first person we had over here too.
He's a controversial character, but so are we, and probably that's why we get along. I remember Brian talking about us one time. He goes, and then there's Michael Carell and Marta, they are controversial characters, which probably is why Christian gravitates to such people.
You said that?
Yeah, I was so proud. But yes, the long answer to the short question was yes.
Yeah. So how do you know Christian?
I have never met him, but he calls me occasionally and we just shoot the shit. And I'm like...
He'll talk your ear off.
Yeah.
I found him to be quite interesting, and we've never had the opportunity to meet, which sucks. Yeah. So
He's one of the people who goes to Salem every Halloween, so he's not even here when you're in town for the ball.
Yeah, right? That sucks.
Yeah, he's always in Salem. He didn't go last year because of COVID, but that's usually where he goes every year. Oh, well.
Christian Day. I hear so many good and evil, diabolical things about him. So I just be quiet and talk to him when he calls me.
Well, you know, since we went there, those of you listening to the live broadcast, an hour after our show tonight is the second episode of Christian's new show, where he's going to seriously spill some serious tea and rip off some serious wigs tonight. So we were almost not even going to broadcast on Monday, but there was like, well, we got, you know, it's an hour away. Why the fuck not? We got to get all these people on. So that's going to be something. We got to tune in that Hex Education on YouTube, and it'll be on his Facebook page, and we'll be watching with you. It'll be something. I mean, we gossip over here, but, you know, we're not that good at it.
Oh, you're not?
We're not that good at our gossip. Well, we learn most of our gossip from him.
Yeah, a lot of it we get from Christian. So hearing him say it will definitely be good.
Yeah. Well, Christian is an interesting character, and I'm very curious to see where he goes. But I tried to see him when I was in New Orleans for Halloween, because he was actually in Halloween for New Orleans for once.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I'm just imagining, like, him and me being in the same town at the same time and not hanging out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, he does hang out at Potions a lot. He did before COVID.
Yeah, he invited us there a couple times when we moved here. But it's like, dude, we have a kid. Yeah. Don't have a babysitter.
How's your kid?
So, Father Sebastian has at least three books. There was, I think the other two I saw were expansions on a couple of those books or something. Can you tell us tell us about your books?
Well, I have three books out. I have Sanguinomicon, which is my magnum opus. That is my biggest success, and that was published by Wiser Books in 2010. Mm-hmm. Then there's Vampire Magic, its sequel. A lot of people think Vampire Magic's independent, but Vampire Magic is actually complementary to Sanguinomicon. And this practice is the practice of the Strigovai tradition, which is basically translation roughly to living vampire witch. It's a pagan style form of vampirism that deals with energy and spirituality and ancestor worship. Then Strigovai Light, which is the Black Veils, and that is basically a guide to the newcomer to the vampire community that doesn't want to get too hardcore, that wants to be pretty light. So I suggest reading Black Veils before anything. And Black Veils is kind of the guide for the new vampire.
And that's the name of the class you're doing for WitchCon?
Yeah.
Veil Vampire.
Yeah. I'm basically doing a class on vampire magic.
Mm-hmm.
At VAMPYREMAGICK. Mm-hmm. I'm fixing my listing.
You're fixing the listing?
Yeah, it's spelled vampire with an I.
Yeah.
So I gotta get Christian to fix that up.
So you want to change the I to a Y?
Yes, please. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I'll tell him. I talk to him pretty often. I do the editing for Warlock Press, and he should have had me read this over. But, yeah. I'll tell him.
Extra for that.
Okay, yeah. I'll tell him to fix it.
What I'm doing is Wiser has given me special permission to do a special edition, second edition special entitled Strigovai,
We have one of those lag outs that Skype's so famous for. Can you say the title of the book again, or the title again?
Strigabai. Path of the Vampire Witch.
Path of the Vampire Witch. Whew, I love the sound of that. Yeah. So, can you tell us, like, what are some of the similarities and or differences between vampire magic and the classical forms that we would tend to know?
Well, I have just that prepared by chance.
What do you know? Psychic.
Yes. So I wrote something that will be read for the first time in public, a definition of what I believe vampires are. And let me read that to you.
Yeah.
It's called Vampirism. Okay. You ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Vampires are sovereign individuals who are self-initiated and energy sensitive that in practice are part alchemist, part witch, and part magician. Vampires, when spelled with a Y, are generally distinct from psychic vampires, which are energy deficient individuals, and sanguinarians, blood drinkers. Vampires learn to gather life force energy by interacting with the environment around them. Then they refine this gathered energy into a higher form known as ambrosia through a highly sacred alchemical act known to vampires as communion. Once this act is completed, the vampire can, as an individual or group, direct ambrosia towards a goal or an intention through vampire magic and sorcery. The vampire current is the collective egregore of elemental energy and the frequency of the vampire mythos and archetype throughout the entire human consciousness. The vampire learns to tap this. Black veils are a collection of traditions, culture, words of power, and teachings researched by me on my 25-year journey through the vampire culture and current. Example veils include immortality, dragon, primal, romance, mystery, transhumanism, music, culture, elegance, glamour, courtesy, chivalry, magic, ritual, libertine, and sensuality. There are three basic levels of vampiric self-initiation according to the Black Veils, which one can become a vampire adept. These are known as ordeals and include coming forth by day, coming forth by night, and coming forth by twilight. And there's higher levels of initiation known as magisters, which are not known to the public. So that is basically my definition of vampirism. And if you want to call it Strigabai as the tradition, then you can do that. And if you want to practice something different, as long as you're not involving minors, there's two cardinal rules of vampires. You never involve minors. Period. Zip, zilch, zero. Kids. No kids. Okay? Mm-hmm. Teach them Wicca or witchcraft or yoga or Gnostic Christianity, but keep them out of the vampire world, period. Okay? And the second rule is stay within the law. All vampires got to respect Muggle law. And that's basically it.
That sounds like a complete system and a statement of intent or a mission statement. And yeah, so how many people, how many vampires do you think practice in that system around the world?
I think a good majority of the vampire community goes with that system. There are exceptions to the rules because vampires are exceptions. There's lots of fashion vampires. There's different types of vampires. Okay, vampire with the Y is like more of a witchy vampire magician. Then there's psychic vampires who you meet in everyday society. Okay, they're not psychic as in psychic, but they're more like suppressive people. The people that are parasitic.
We don't like those.
But there's also psychic vampires known as ethical psychic vampires who are aware of their condition and they're prone to massive amounts of drama, but they're trying to balance their energy. Okay, and the majority of the vampire community that you meet online identifies as a psychic or a sanguine. Most of the people I know are vampire with a Y.
Yeah.
And then there's sanguinarians, which are blood drinkers. I was one many years. I still partake occasionally with a consenting donor who's been blood tested, but it's not my primary practice because getting enough energy to be able to perform my vampire magic from one person is a little difficult because I turn them into a prune.
That makes sense.
Blood is the life, baby. But for most vampires, blood is life force is metaphorical for life force. Most of the big vampire organizations do not condone or include blood drinking in their practices.
Mm-hmm. No, the only time I drank blood, I threw up afterwards. So that would probably be hard pass for me. What?
There were other times.
Other times?
Yeah, put in a little wine, you know.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Never mind.
Yeah, I mean, the biggest misconception is vampires need to drink gallons of blood.
Uh-huh.
That's not a reality. It's like a pit. It's like a... Hello, doggy.
Again.
Let out the hounds.
All right, I think he's winding down. Okay, go ahead. You're saying.
Okay. Yeah, it doesn't have to be large amounts.
No, they only use a pinprick.
Yeah.
Like, okay. Like they just need a little bit. They don't need a lot. They don't need a glass full. Okay. They don't need to like have a faucet with blood coming out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
What I've done is I've used lancelets for diabetics.
Uh-huh.
And had my donor tested, but I haven't done it in a while. But I'm craving blood. I do crave blood occasionally. But my organizations don't have blood drinking as a part of our practice. Uh-huh. It's a legal liability. So like no. In other words, my events are takeout only.
Well, you know, once upon a time, that was a thing practiced in the craft relatively often. Nobody ever talks about it anymore, but you know, the idea of initiation back in the day was like to alter a person's bloodline so they became one of the blood. And in some traditions, they'd do that. You know, drop a blood, glass of wine. That's the wine that you're toasting with at your initiation. Boom. Same thing at a mafia initiation too. There's Godfather's blood is in the wine, and that alters your bloodline. Maybe it was an Italian idea. I don't know, but not that odd. Well, I've always said that. Yeah, you know, we get along with vampires. We don't really hang out with werewolves, but I'll hang out with a Frankenstein's monster or a mummy too.
Yeah.
Sure.
You want me to address the werewolf legend?
Yeah.
Well, a lot of people go to me. They're like, do werewolves get along with vampires? And I'm like, oh, boy, here we go.
Oh, yeah, that whole thing was at Twilight or I forget which show. Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
World, but the original idea for vampires versus werewolves came from a role-playing game called Vampire the Masquerade, 1992, which is the third greatest influence on the vampire legend in history. Vampire the Masquerade was a role-playing game that came out kind of like Dungeons and Dragons, mm-hmm. where you have a storyline where there's a conspiracy called the Camarilla, which has a law called the Masquerade that vampires cannot present themselves to humans or they have to kill them. Mm-hmm. So as to protect the vampires from the... So the Masquerade is this law. And the culture of the Vampire the Masquerade really has had an impact on the vampire community. But Underworld, True Blood, Twilight, and True Blood, Twilight, Underworld, and Blade all ripped Vampire the Masquerade's structure off. Because Vampire the Masquerade...
Yeah, I was going to say that. That was big in Santa Cruz for a while in the 90s.
Yeah.
Those are the same people that later played like Magic and stuff.
Yeah.
Vampire the Masquerade is probably the most complete mythology of vampires and most deep mythology of fictional vampirism in history. It ties together everything. You can be a Lost Boys vampire, you can be a Nosferatu, you can be a wizard, you can, like, they have different clans with different specialities and different personalities. Mm-hmm. And Vampire the Masquerade, it has been a great influence on the vampire culture and was a place that vampires before the internet would meet at the LARPs, live action vampire games, would meet to find each other. And I went networking at Vampire LARPs in New York because it was like a front for vampires. Mm-hmm. And I met a bunch of people in the vampire community in New York back in the 90s, and they were eccentric people, I'll tell you that.
I kind of think, you know, I kind of expect that from vampires. I don't know why. Maybe it's Hollywood. Mm-hmm. I expect eccentric types.
Mm.
That lived a really long time and have a lot of cool antiques.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I know that's not all true. That's Holly. That's like witches flying broomsticks and shit. Yeah.
I know better. Be best.
But I do expect him to be eccentric. I don't know why.
Yeah.
Well, vampires have defined my life, but I also practice warlockism.
Describe to us this warlockism of which you speak.
Well, I heard you're into it too, but I want to see if our definitions match up.
Okay.
So, I am a straight guy. I'm a white straight guy, but I love. I grew up in the East Village, so minorities. I was one of them. I was a minority, and I was also a. You know, the vast majority of the vampire community is women. 75%
really?
Are women.
I think that's similar to witchcraft. Yeah.
Sure. And I learned from Herman Schlater, who ran a shop called Magical Child.
But you actually go to the shop. I just know his books. Grew up on those. Yeah.
Yeah,
I totally forgot about Magical Child.
I identify as a hermetic witch.
The shop where I grew up in Long Beach, still, that's all it says on the door is hermetic supplies. They haven't changed it. It's been there since the 60s, and that's all. And most, you know, your average, you know, millennial witch, they don't know a fucking hermetic from a fucking hole in the ground. They won't know what that is.
Well, you know, they will know. They will figure it out. The hermetic magician is pretty badass.
Well, I always teach my students, like, you know, it all comes from there. I don't care what magical system you're practicing, and this pissed off a lot of people when I first said it. You're all following the same laws. Whether it be a folk magic or an ATR or witchcraft classic, it's all going to go back to hermetics. And so is science, and so is medicine. It's all going to come from there. We all originally came from the same place.
Can you hold on a second? Someone is at my door, and
Why don't we do a musical break? I was just getting ready to go pee anyways. Be right back.
Down on my knees in praise of them. Horrible things that took place.
Stellar Corpses, Vampire's Kiss on Winterson's Radio. And then I heard the Misfits doing something. Oh, Dig Up Her Bones before that. And it sounds like our guest is back. There's some question about the URL changing on our show. We're dealing with listeners, and I don't know. I still type in spreaker.com/user/Wittershins, and it takes us right to the show. So I don't know why they can't find it. No, but look, if I type in spreaker.com/user/Wittershins, that's how I get to the show. But then it says Michael Carell's show. But look at spreaker.com/user/Wittershins. That brought me to the show. So I don't know what's going on. We'll figure that out later. Okay, well, something went wrong there, because there it is. I will figure out what the hell that is. But somebody, some of you were all saying that we should get on Spotify. Now we're on Spotify, too. You can find Wittershins at Spotify, iHeartRadio, iTunes Podcast, or Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Tumblr, shit, and YouTube, and I don't know where else, but we're typically here Wednesdays at 5 p.m. Central Time. But as we've been telling you people for years, we've been just giving you the tip of our much larger package. With our package here at Spreaker, we can go on 3 hours per day, unlimited times per day, which means we could just go on for 3 hours, restart, 3 hours, restart. All day. We could go 24/7 if we had no lives, nothing to do. And apparently we're kind of doing that with WitchCon. We're going to be here every motherfucking day, and sometimes twice a day, interviewing people from WitchCon, especially because of all the controversy surrounding WitchCon. And, you know, us being a show that, you know, courts controversy. So you were mentioning, Father, that I think you said Wiser was your first book. Was it both book or all three books, Wiser?
No, Wiser was the publisher of Sanguinomicon and Vampire Magic.
Okay.
And then Bast Books is my imprint that I run.
Okay, so with the exception of the book that, you know, you're the publisher. On the other ones, Wiser, you know, are you now or have you ever been coerced by your publisher to appear at WitchCon? There's a controversy out there on the internet. I don't know if you know about it.
No, tell me about this controversy.
It's we're now calling them quitches. They're like QAnon, but they're witches.
They use exactly the same tactics as QAnon. They're like, I have all this evidence, but I can't show you.
Yeah, but and different conspiracy theories. See, we have our own internal deep state cabal within the occult community, and of course, Christian Day is at the head.
Yeah.
And
so Christian is Trump? What are you talking about?
They actually compared Christian to Trump at one point on the same people. But that their latest conspiracy
theory.
I know. So it's twisted. It's not, you know, they're like QAnon, but they have different conspiracy theories. But they're still, you know, conspiracy theories.
I'm curious. You got me curious. Don't leave me hanging.
So the latest conspiracy theory is that authors from Llewellyn and Wiser are forced under contract to appear at Christian Day's events and by the publisher. And they also have a gag contract. They're not allowed to talk about that. That's the conspiracy.
Can't talk about
so it's
gag.
A perfect conspiracy. It's like, there's a conspiracy, but I can't really tell you, and they can't talk about it.
They know for a fact.
They know for a fact that this is true.
Yeah, Wiser was very adamant that I only go to WitchCon, and then I bow before Christian Day, and I give him my Burger King crown, and we go off into the sunset eating oysters.
Did you have to kiss his ring?
No, well, we kind of kiss each other's rings.
Yeah, so far, many authors have come out publicly to, you know, some are even offering to show their contract, and but you know, it's these are like QAnon, but with witchcraft. Facts aren't going to bother them
saying,
at all.
You know, even if they say that they want to be there and that they, you know, voluntarily are doing WitchCon, they're lying.
It's under duress.
Yeah.
You seem like an under duress kind of guy that the people would do that kind of thing to. push you around and shit.
I totally. Christian Day pushes me around, and he has ordered me to not speak about all of this stuff on Facebook and your show.
All right, there you go. They're right. The Quitches are right. They're going to share this show. But hey, that's just more clicks, baby.
Yeah.
So let's see. Okay, so it's the books, and then you're teaching. What did we talk? The vampire witchcraft thing. What's it called again? Oh, the Black Veil. Black Veil. Yes, yes.
I teach Black Veils. I work with Johanna Maresco from the Crew Shadows, a very famous goth band, and she is my keeper of the scrolls. And what we do is we do every Thursday, Wednesday and Thursday, we do the Thursday. Now, there's some teachings that are important to know in the vampire culture. Okay, when you talk about your day side, you're talking about your muggle life, your mom and dad, work and all that stuff, and to paying taxes and living in the real world. And
God, I used to have one of those.
We encourage people to have relationships with their family, unlike most cults. And then the second one, yeah, because actually the first sign of a cult is disconnection from your mundane family. And we do the opposite. We're like, conquer them, take them on, and celebrate Christmas and Easter with them, and invite them to your wedding, and make them a part of your life. And then the second one is coming forth by night, which is the spiritual element, the metaphysical element, the magical element, the vampire element of the person. And then you have your night, your twilight, which is where you tie the two together and you learn how to balance the two. So you got to learn the day side first, then you got to learn the night side, and then you got to tie them together in the twilight. And when you complete those three things, you become adept. An adept is like being a mature adult vampire.
So is that like, is that initiation for y'all? Because you're autonomous. You said that in the beginning.
Self-initiation. Vampires are very independent, yet highly social. And most vampires are considered themselves, whether they know it or not, left-hand path.
Mm-hmm. Yes. How would you describe the left-hand path? I always like to hear people's take on that.
I think it's really simple. It's the path of disjunction, where right-hand path religions are most common. And it's things like Christianity, join me and live forever, Jesus would say. Islam is a right-hand path religion. Judea is a right-hand path religion. Gnostic Christianity, Buddhism, Satanism, and vampirism are left-hand path traditions, which means that you want to be independent of God. You can acknowledge a God. You can do business with a God. But you don't. When you pass away, you want to continue existence as you, not as a part of another deity. And that's where the whole immortality thing comes in for vampires.
That makes sense. When I was a kid, I remember when Star Wars came out, and witches of that time were talking about all of the witchcraft stuff that was in Star Wars, like, you know, the Force, that kind of thing. But a specific one that they hit on was that the Jedi and the Sith were like the right-hand path and left-hand path, in that... In my day, the left-hand path was described as if a left-hand path practitioner believed that God existed within the person. And a right-hand path believed that God existed outside the person. So the right-hand path believed in serving externals or serving others, and the left-hand path believed in serving the self. But to some of them, they were serving their gods by serving themselves. And we were always, you know, brought up as witches that these were diametrically opposed viewpoints, but over time I've seen them merge together, and most people tend to believe that, you know, if they believe in gods, they're within us and without us, which ultimately just takes us back to hermetics in the first place, as above, so below. So we've kind of come full circle, I think.
I can see that perspective, but from, you know, the traditions of the left-hand path, like the Temple of Set, which is a pretty hardcore LHP tradition, and probably the prominent one, you know, apotheosis or self-deification or deification of the individual is an important element of left-hand path. It's probably the cornerstone of it. Patty has a very different definition that is interesting. But, I mean, in the end, it's objective versus subjective. So I don't want to die. I pretty much figured that out. I want to live a long and healthy, happy life. My relationship with time is different from other people. My perspectives are different. And I love being a vampire. And I'm addressing myself as the Vampire Sebastian now. Father Sebastian is my official prominence in the vampire community. But a lot of people go to me, how did the vampire community start? And I go, well, that's a long, long story.
Well, I've often told this weird tale. I have many stories, you know, to fill the airtime. But I was at Headwaters Forest in Northern California, working with Earth First, and I, you know, we do crazy stuff during the day, and then we party all night. And I remember going off into the meadow and finding some bush with this woman that I was with, and I woke up and she wasn't there anymore. And I'm out in this blazing hot sun, and I don't have my sunglasses with me. And I'm like a vampire, man. I can't fucking handle the light. And staggering across the field, looking for some fucking coffee. And I saw these people all dressed in black around this fire, and they had one of those stovetop espresso makers that they were sticking right in the fire. No, the big metal kind of where it bubbles up from the bottom and comes up through the thing. And they just like stuck it right in the fire. And I walked up and I saw a pentagram and I said, oh, merry meet. And they said, good morning, brother. Would you like to sit down and invoke the goddess Caffeine with us? And I said, oh, fuck yes, I do. So about like halfway into my fucking cup of coffee, I'm seeing, you know, pentagrams, you know, everybody's in dark clothes and cloaks and stuff. And, you know, once the, you know, my eyes started unblurring. Every one of them had capped vampire teeth, really nice ones like Father Sebastian would do for people. It was like it was a coven of fucking vampire witches. They had all come up to save the Headwaters Forest trees. And, that was probably the first vampires I met, really.
Where was this?
This is Headwaters Forest, Humboldt County, California. God, I guess the 90s. It was the 90s. I don't think Headwaters Forest is still standing, but we tried.
Wow. Well, that sounds like my kind of witches.
Mm-hmm.
Fire witches.
And I was cool. I mean, they gave me coffee, so I'm not going to trip.
Did
you know?
You ask about the thing?
No, I didn't say shit, man. You got to be polite.
I drank,
like, you know, like hopefully, you know, people don't ask me about my missing tooth, you know.
Yeah.
That's rude. Go ahead, Father.
I sadly am found out that coffee is not good for me.
I'm sure it's not good for me, but I have to have it. I haven't found a substitute, and I can't go back to speed. I'm too old. Let's see. So I was going to add. Oh, so all right. So vampire witchery with a Y. Tools. What would be the common tools in such practice?
Witchcraft is, you know, witchcraft is interesting because, like, for example, let me try to explain this. We use the typical ritual tools. Let me go into the Sanguinomicon here and find some listings. There's a chapter on ritual tools. So the Gnostic Mass is our...
I went to one when I was a kid. I remember tripping when I realized we were reading the Lord's Prayer backwards, but then they explained to me why.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cute. Location of ritual. Let me see here. Regalia, the tools of ritual. We have an altar, the arthana. See, arthana is the original French name for a word that you probably know in the craft as athame. The original word is atharna, a black-hilted double-edged blade. Then the altar usually faces west.
Jesus, dog. Sorry about that. Go ahead. Altar faces.
The altar faces west, and we do widdershins northwest in our callings.
Okay, I think you were saying that to me. Yeah.
Candle, like witches. Chalices are symbolic of life force and blood, but it's charged with life force. It's not necessarily blood. The speculum is a black mirror and a wand.
Speculum is the traditional name. Very good. Most of those kids aren't going to know what you're talking about, but yeah. It's like I got a friend, he's like teaching wart cutting. I'm going, oh, well, that's great. Nobody knows what the fuck you're talking about. I do.
We're going to have him on.
It's like people that, I got a friend, he wanted to name his book Ars something. I go, oh, well, that's a cool old occult reference that none of these kids understand anymore. those are all classical tools, and some people tend to associate those with Wicca. And I always argue with those people. It's like, you know what? Gardner didn't originate shit. He was the ultimate appropriator. He spent a lifetime studying religio magic around the world. That was the story. And then he met the New Forest witches. And then he did his Wicca thing. And so he borrowed from every magical culture he could. And I do a whole, I got a whole series of witchcraft without Wicca. But we cover those tools, and why we still use those tools is because they didn't come from Gardner. They came from Solomon. They came from Agrippa. All of the old grimoires, all of those tools, the black-handled, the white-handled, the sword, the blasting rod. Sure, not everybody has a blasting rod these days, but, you know, kids should. But they're classical tools. He didn't make that up. So much of... witchcraft is borrowed from those grimoires. It makes perfect sense for all of those tools to be in various traditions. And that sounded like all the standards. You had a bell too, right?
Yeah, of course. You got the bell, yeah. Book, and candle.
See, a lot of traditions don't do the bell these days. It kind of gets lost in the times of Wicca. A lot of really important shit gets lost through the times of Wicca. People don't even know why they're doing half that shit anymore because of fucking Wicca. Sorry, you go on. It's your time.
Yes. I'm just overwhelmed with like talking to someone who knows what they're talking about outside of my circle. It's great.
Me too, brother. I mean, there's plenty of good practitioners here in New Orleans, but I just I have a long memory with regard to magic. I have a terrible short-term memory because I'm a pot smoker from hell. But when it comes to magic and witchcraft, I remember all this shit that everybody just doesn't remember anymore. And I come off all wise and shit. It's like, nah, that's just everybody fucking knew that back then. Everybody knew the same shit once upon a time. We all had some standards. I don't know what the standards are anymore.
Well, I think that magic is, you know... I think magic is interpreted in different ways, and that's the great thing about different paradigms. At the core, I'm a chaos magician.
I was just about to talk about that. In your bio, it says you teach chaos magic, and Of course, I'm fascinated.
Do you know much about the chaos?
Yes. Favorite author? Who's your favorite author?
My favorite author is Peter J. Carroll. And yes. He wrote Weber Nolan's Psycho, my Bible.
Yes.
So,
mine's going to be
homage to him.
Mine's going to be Phil Hine.
Phil Hine's pretty damn good.
Phil Hine just makes it easier to understand. Like, I used to, I co-founded the longest running pirate radio station in the country. I think it's still running like 25 years later. And I used to do a late night show where I would read his books with a little, was kind of some background music, some spooky background music. And it was just like the perfect books to translate to radio. It was just like everybody got it. And it's like, you go to like Austin Osman's Spare. It's like, okay, well, reading Spare is like reading Solomon or Agrippa or Abramelin. They have like this crazy old mage speak that nobody ever talks about anymore. And Phil Hine was just like straight up, you know, in your face. And he was quite a character. I like that of my, the grand old men of witchcraft, chaos, magic, or anything. I want them to be larger than life and hugely controversial characters, or I don't want to read their shit. Basically.
Well, I think that chaos magic is the centerpiece of all chaos magic. I lived in an IOT, Limits of Thanatos Temple in Amsterdam.
What is it? IOT. Say it again.
The Illuminates of Thanateros.
I don't know them.
They invented chaos magic.
They invented chaos magic. Really?
Yeah. So if you want to know
about... Everybody gives Spare the credit for that.
Well, Spare created the sigil work, okay, which is a major element of chaos magic, but the IOT is really what codified chaos magic. And they really defined chaos magic. And it was an organization founded by Peter J. Carroll, who's kind of like the supreme magus of things. So what I've learned is that Aeonic words, okay, are words that change history. Like LeVay, Aleister Crowley spoke Thelema, okay? And Crowley and Anton LaVey spoke indulgence. Magus, and Michael Aquino spoke Capiru, okay, or Capira. And Magus are people who speak Aeonic words that change history, okay? Basically, the co-magnus of chaos magic, what we call chaos magic, was Peter J. Carroll. He was the supreme magus. The IOT is what really shaped the concept of chaos magic. I'm not sure if Phil Hine was IOT, but
I don't know exactly.
IOT is like a very elite crack organization of chaos magicians that was founded I believe Germany or England in the 1978, the IOT was formed. If you look up chaos magic, IOT is all over it.
It has to be something that I've come across, but I'm going to have to look more. Originated chaos magic. Well, the beauty of Phil Hine is like, he only had like two main books, but he'd already published all of the material for those books in PDF forms before that. So it's like everything's out there. He just kind of dropped off the map sometime in the early 2000s. But all of his work's just out there for free in PDF form still to this day.
Well, I come from the IOT school, and it looks here on Wikipedia that proto-chaos magic was Austin Osman Spare, okay, based on results-based magic. But the real fathers of chaos magic were Peter J. Carroll and Ray Sherwin of the IoT. Mila Minutes of Thanateros.
You read the same thing I read right before the show. I was on your Wikipedia, and it talked about the different things that you practiced, and I clicked on that description of chaos magic. So I totally understand what you're saying.
Another very important element of chaos magic is Genesis Peorage and Grant Morrison. Okay. Grant Morrison created the concept of a hyper sigil, and Genesis Peorage was the head of the Temple of Psychic Youth, which was an incredible organization. And Psychic TV, and wow, what an incredible current. Because I believe there's different currents, and people are drawn to different currents. Like Crowley's current was 93. But what confuses me is that people don't know what an egregore is. The most basic fundamental element of all magic.
Yeah. Have you ever read Urban Primitive?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a classic. I mean, you know, these extra egregores, but squat shows up. Probably the best description for any time I've ever tried to describe an egregore, I'm going to talk about squat. But when I knew squat was an experiment by Isaac Bonowitz's coven in like the 80s in Berkeley as a god of parking. And by the time it reaches,
I used it in Berkeley. I had the best parking ever.
Oh, it's probably
ever.
Way powerful in Berkeley.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, squats powerful everywhere. It worked in
shit.
Hollywood.
My friends thought it was full of shit. Yeah. They weren't witches, and I was like, so I did it, and like right then, a spot right in front of the restaurant, yeah. A car pulled out, and they shut up.
Squats some
serious
shit.
Yeah.
But then
yeah.
By the time Urban Primitive rolls around, yeah. Squats transgendered itself. Has acquired worshipers all over the world, stepped out of its box. It was originally just for parking. Now squat's going to find you a spot to squat your ass. Squat's a housing deity, too. And developed, like originally squat, you fed other people's parking meters so they wouldn't get a ticket as a sacrament to squat. But the new squat, dirty jokes and limericks. We only know two limericks, but we'll say them when we're looking for a parking spot, and it always works out.
Nantucket.
There's probably a lot from Nantucket, but we only know one.
Yeah, and I know another one. Yeah.
WitchCon group for presenters?
Is there a WitchCon group?
What's that?
Is there a secret YouTube or Facebook group for presenters of WitchCon?
Huh. Good idea. I don't think there is.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
Well,
that would be a good thing to do, though. But there's going to be, there's like a Zoom thing where you can, like, hang out and socialize with people. We did that last year at Hexfest because we were all home. And our dog, you know how you would use Zoom? If you make noise, your camera takes over. Like, we had stepped out. We were inside the house, and our goddamn puppy loves to steal Marta's coffee. And Marta had a spoon in her coffee, which made a lot of noise. We came back out. All the Zoom people were going, "Hey, Marta, your puppy was drinking your coffee. It was all up in our grill." So that could be kind of fun. You know, we gotta make the most of this virtual thing and act like we're really there and hang out with each other and shit.
Yeah.
But yeah, that would be a good idea, but I haven't heard of that yet. A Facebook group for the presenters. So then we'd have to have one for Hexfest. Hopefully you'll do a Hexfest and come here in person. Now that we live here, I'm pretty much booked for every Hexfest, unless I really piss off Christian Day, I'll be at every Hexfest for the foreseeable future.
Oh, cool.
And it's really easy. When you live here, you only have to do one workshop. Like, when they flew me in and paid for my hotel and stuff, I had to do three.
Yep.
I drunk off my ass for one of them, but I still did it. I taught some magical warfare.
What was your class?
I did, what was it? Magical Warfare, Laying Plans, Magical Warfare, Preparing for Battle, and Magical Warfare, Crush the Enemy. And when the Catholic Church protested the event last year, or no, 2 years ago, they did this little propaganda film, and they named like several workshops, and only, you know, one of them wasn't mine. And they have this guy on the Catholic Church going, and they're teaching magical warfare, crush the enemy. I just, the guy's voice was so ominous, I wanted to just like pay him money to walk behind me down the street just all day long, just go, crush the enemy, crush the enemy. Just like a motivator kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then WitchCon, I'm doing Magical Warfare, The Art of Deception. People seem to like the magical warfare thing because nobody else is going to teach that shit. So I started on a high. I entered the game with magical warfare, and I don't know where to go from there.
Well, I think that's a really great idea, and I think you should continue that.
I'm working on a... Eventually, I'll be putting out a book called The Art of Magical Warfare, but I'm not an author. I need a scribe. I need to sit there and talk and have somebody write down everything I fucking say, because whenever I type something, it's really short.
World.
What's that?
That's a luxury. I wish I could do that.
Yeah, it's just whenever I type something, it's just really short. When I talk, I'm, well, you know, I tell stories.
You can talk into a table or have somebody.
Yeah, I can maybe do that too. I'll get there. You know, we know a really good publisher, and they have the best editor in the world. Warlock Press. Which reminds me, I think it's about time I need to actually plug the thing that we're talking about. Let's see, witchcon.com. There we go. So, the thing we've been talking about, people, as you might imagine, because we've been plugging it for a while now, we're going to be plugging it every day this month, and a couple times on Tuesday. Bring the magic to you. WitchCon Online, March 5th to the 7th, 2021. Join the largest online magical conference in the world, featuring over 100 witches and conjurers. Coming to you by live stream video from across the globe. WitchCon Online presenters are the preeminent masters of the arts and hail from across the spectrum of occult and magical practices. Registration is limited to 1,000 attendees, people, so you better get on it. Attendees and fans will love the virtual Vendorium. You can go shopping. It's going to be almost like you're really there. Our virtual meet and greet lets attendees and fans alike chat with presenters live on Zoom and is a great way to get to know your favorite teachers. WitchCon Online is live streamed on the Hex Education Network on Crowdcast, a web-based platform with no need to download. And so as I've told you people before, I can't even start to read you the presenters. Sometimes I'll read 3 or 4 of them, but there's like well over 100. Biggest names that there are, and that's part of why these other people have such a problem with it, and why we've got these, you know, this little mob attacking Hexfest. Well, those are the mob of the authors that didn't get invited come to the fucking show. The Bay Area social justice warriors that were not invited to WitchCon, you know, banded together a bunch of we call them quitches. QAnon witches, but so we're doing our part as everybody, you know. We were talking earlier about the contract. I signed a contract. My contract didn't force me to be there. My contract said that, you know, if I, you know, didn't say, you know, bow out by a certain date, I better have a good excuse. That makes sense. My contract said that I need to share the event on my social media. So we have gone above and beyond our obligation to WitchCon in that regard, because we're going to be advertising WitchCon every fucking day and night. We're going to be doing 2 shows tomorrow. We're going to be here at 5, and we're going to take a break at 7, and we're going to be back at 10 with Fiona Horn. We'll be all up in this shit. because you don't fuck with the guy that teaches magical warfare. You don't try and pull that shit. And you don't fuck with friends of mine either. And Father Sebastian's a friend of mine, so don't you fuck with him either. I'll be up in your shit.
Yeah,
all right?
I've been through nightmares.
All right, I've again met my contractual obligations for this hour. I have paid the bills, as it were. All right, so you teach chaos magic too?
I do. I teach basic stuff because I like introducing people to the world of magic. And you know, a lot of people peg me as only a vampire, but I'm a chaos magician. I'm a shaman. I did not know that until we started talking. I'm an adult vampire, and I'm a intermediate practitioner of chaos magic. I don't really like to define myself. I mean, publicly, my business is vampires, but I love to teach chaos magic because it's really practical magic.
Absolutely.
Get shit done, man.
Yeah, I often say it's like chaos magicians study all of the classical magic and just come up with new ideas, new ways to use it. And I have taken chaos idea. I mean, like sigil magic. Ultimately, sigil magic is going to take us back to the Solomon, Agrippa, Abramelin. That was their idea. But then over time, our idea of spirit changes. And sigil magic and chaos magic, I would coin as the spirit of an idea in text turned into a symbol. So it's kind of, you know, it's kind of like a full circle thing, but it's like chaos magicians can innovate. They can come up with new drastic ways of doing things that somehow, you know, the classical witches and the Wiccans, that they seem limited. They have to stick with tradition. Chaos magic doesn't. They damn the tradition. Do whatever the fuck they want. Nothing's true. Everything's forbidden. Yeah. Woo. Okay. What were you saying? I'm sorry. I started ranting too.
No, I was loving hearing your voices.
Good. Oh, dear. What was that? I was going to... Oh, damn. I have so many questions that I was going to ask, and I keep forgetting stuff. So you talk.
You should have written them down.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I hate that. I hate reading written questions. I sound like I'm reading written questions.
No, you just write them down and then don't look at it, but it'll help you remember.
Oh, that's what I was going to say. It's like, yeah, I didn't know until we started talking about the show that you were teaching several types of magic and chaos magic. I mean, I kind of assume we met you with Patty, you know?
Sure, and why is Patty not speaking at WitchCon?
I don't know. Well, okay. Patty's the good witch. This is a controversial figure we're associating with, but that's part of what I like about the guy. I don't know. You know, I just think of Patty's really nice. I know she'd fuck you up if she needed to, but I just think of like some of these mobsters that have harassed other presenters. You know, if they fucked with Patty, like how she'd take that. But she does label herself the good witch.
She's good at being a witch. She's not a white witch.
Ah. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I don't even know if Christian knows who she is.
Yeah.
We're going to tell him about her. Well, yeah, you were on the same show. Christian was on Ghost Adventures once upon a time.
Yeah, man.
I never saw that, but I've seen Patty. I've seen you. Are you still doing Ghost Adventures pretty often? Or I think you're kind of a regular.
I don't like doing TV. I don't. Let Patty do it.
Patty spends her whole life on a red carpet. You know, I love that about her.
Yeah, she has. and she gets me to go to her red carpets. To be honest with you, I'm not after the fame, and it's a pain in the ass. It's like. It just makes things challenging. I really like... I'm really, really a private person. And fame just makes people... Like, butt into your life.
Yeah. Come up to you on the street, dox you on the internet. And,
yeah.
I feel you. Yep. But, brother, that ship has sailed. I'm sorry. I don't think you can go back into that broom closet. You're famous.
No.
Deal with it.
I like calling attention to myself.
Yeah.
I like to share my projects with people who wouldn't share my passions. Okay. And my manager and all these people, like, the people that get the most fame are the ones that don't want it. And I'm not in any encouragement. Like, Zach's asked me to go on a couple times, and I love his show. I think it's great, and everything that happened to me was legitimate and real. And a lot of people go, is that stuff fake? And I go, no, it's real. It's very true. And I'm just very, like, I just don't want to be on TV. Patty, that's for Patty, man. She can do it all day and all night. I'm just not into it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I got on Cursed Films, mm-hmm. episode 2. I thought it was pretty cool. We had like a whole film crew at our house when we were in Hollywood, a lighting crew and a boom mic. It was nuts. I had fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could do that.
Yeah.
I mean, we're on camera all day and microphone pretty much every day anyways.
Yep.
Really. Wasn't a huge stretch, but when we lived in Hollywood, that was like the only industry thing that I did when we lived in Hollywood.
Well, I find that the most industry things happen outside of Hollywood.
Yeah, I mean, New Orleans is huge. I see more production trucks here, even during COVID, than I would see around Hollywood. And, you know, most of the trucks you'd see in Hollywood were production trucks.
You know what's funny is most of the media thinks I live in New Orleans.
I thought when we originally met, I friended you under a different name, but I couldn't remember what that name was when I was trying to get a hold of you for the show. But it said you lived in New Orleans on your page.
I have several profiles as decoys.
Yeah.
And the only two profiles that matter, well, three, are my Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Mm-hmm. I'm at Father Sebastian at Twitter and Instagram and Facebook. And I'm validated on Facebook and Instagram, and you know it's me. Otherwise, you never know. It could be a fake Father Sebastian.
Well, and perfect, because we reached that time of the show where you got to start plugging your websites, your books, like where can people get a hold of you. We know you're going to be at witchcon.com. And just a matter of a couple weeks. But other than that, where can people find you?
People can find me at Father Sebastian, FatherSebastian, at Facebook and Instagram. That's the best places to find me.
Cool. You don't have like a regular web page? YouTube channels, anything. Just all Father Sebastian.
Yeah, Father Sebastian at YouTube, Instagram, Facebook. You can find all my social media links to my fan page, my main page, which is FatherSebastian.com.
And you got to remember the two A's.
Two A's at the end, yeah.
That threw me off. I spelled it wrong one time. I had to go back and edit it.
Yeah.
Luckily, I caught it before the wife did.
No, I'm the one who caught it.
Well, you caught another spelling error with his name.
It was that spelling error.
Huh. And I told you about it. It was that spelling error?
Yep.
Oh, okay. Yeah, see, the editor in the house, she catches that shit. I fuck it up.
Well, give me something to do.
All right, so we're going to see you at WitchCon March 5th. And then you're going to have the Endless Night Vampire thing in October? What's that called?
Yeah, go to endlessnight.com and you can join my Endless Night experience, and tickets for New Orleans are available, and we're almost sold out. We have only 1,000 tickets like WitchCon because COVID response requires us to have 25% less capacity, in my theories, because I think that's important. And all my events and everything, you can go to facebook.com/FatherSebastian/events.
Okay. All right. Well, hopefully we'll all be vaccinated by then, and we'll have a babysitter, mm-hmm. and we'll see you there.
Or we could just leave with the dogs.
Wednesday.
Yeah, we can just leave them with the dogs.
Yeah, no.
Just like tie them to the dogs. House. Nobody's gonna mess with those crazy sounding fools.
Nope.
Well, yeah. Well, hopefully we'll see you soon. I haven't seen you since we first met.
Yep,
that was back in Hollywood.
First and last time, I think.
Well, thanks for coming on, Father Sebastian. It was good to get to know you better. Looking forward to your workshop. I'll be watching that at witchcon.com.
Yes.
See you then, buddy.
Okay.
Rock and roll.
All right, man. Merry part and stuff. All right. Well, he was fun. I knew he would be. I mean, look at that profile picture. Father Sebastian, the Vampire King. Shit.
I don't think
we have anything else to really plug. What?
Oh, are we still on the air?
Yeah, we're still on the air.
Well, you need to tell me, because I was about to start talking massive. I don't even know, but you have to tell me.
Okay, see when we have the big red dot with the square in it, we're still live.
Oh.
Yeah. And also, that little countdown thing, actually it's count up. That's how many, 1 hour, 47 minutes, and 33 seconds we've been on the air. So if those are moving, that's the easy way. If those numbers are moving, we're on the air.
If those green things are jumping up and down.
No, the green things just mean that we're talking. That's the microphone levels and stuff. But as far as the numbers up top, if those are moving, that means we're actually broadcasting. There have been times when I saw those numbers stop moving and we had a problem. That's why I freak out.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Wittershins Radio. This is the start of our marathon of broadcasts.
Well, we're going to be. Say, never mind. I was just going to tell you something that I don't have to say.
Well, that would be great for you to just wait a couple minutes and not say that. Yeah. So, coming up, I don't know if you're listening live or you just hey, the next show. Yeah, a lot of people are downloading this stuff. So tomorrow we're going to be doing Fatima, whose last name we don't know how to say yet, and then at 5 p.m. And then we're going to be back at 10 p.m. Central Time with Fiona Horm. Wednesday the 10th with Jim Sayers. Thursday the 11th, L.A. Barnes. Friday the 12th with Francis Billinghurst. Sunday, February 14th with E. Massey and Alexander Cabot from the Old Witch podcast. Sunday the 15th with Carrie Ewers. Wednesday the 17th, Lola Dorsey. February 19th, Kat the Garb. Wednesday the 24th, Christine Stevens. Friday the 26th with Angie Buchanan. That list may change. We still have a couple days that we're not broadcasting. And if we get... we got a couple slots, and if we hear from some of the people we messaged or other presenters at WitchCon want to be on, or if you know one, let them know we're doing this thing, and we'll fill up those slots. We're committed to at least every one of those days, plugging the hell out of WitchCon to piss off the haters, because that's what people at Wittershins do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wittershins and songs that we haven't heard in a while. We out.
A new age of reason, brain treason to trick the mind. What good is searching if nothing's there to find? We arrive at this place of no return, my brothers, only to discover that our minds have led us away. So bear witness, see the prophet from your loss, beg for forgiveness only after you tally the cost. We arrive at this place of no return, my sisters, only to discover that our values run as a ground on the show.
Righteous proclamations and precious tones of fuel your pulpy conversation.